bags and I'm asking y'all, which part are y'all playing basketball? Get me on the court and I'm troubled. Last week fucked around and got a triple-double. Freaking niggas everywhere like MJ. I can't believe today was a good day.
Happening, man. Let me just fix my camera real quick. Pardon that.
Oh, it's all good.
What's going on, man? How's everything going with you, baby?
Oh, you know, just trying to stay busy with everything, trying to stay productive.
Most definitely. I see you got the LA on. I got to have my Boston on just to represent. You know what
I'm saying? Oh, yeah. You know, I'm always representing for the surf.
Coast to coast with it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm not going to hold you, man. Let's jump right into it, man. This is very important. I've been very excited for this. You know what I'm saying? You know, I've been asking you for a little bit. You know, just to really, I think this is something that's highly important for the culture with everything that you're doing. And, you know, so the people that don't really know, correct me if I'm wrong, it's TAJE or?
It's both.
Both. Okay. So yeah. Which do you
TAJE,
prefer?
TAJE.
Yeah, TAJE. I fuck with TAJE. You know what I'm saying? I like the way that sounds, yeah. Man. TAJE, you're a clinical psychologist, if I'm not mistaken.
I'm a marriage and family therapist.
Okay.
I'm also en route to getting my doctorate next year.
Nice.
And I specialize in clinical psychology.
That's what's up, man. That's dope. Give us a little background as far as with that. I mean, when exactly did you start pursuing that career?
I would say about 7 years ago. Probably about 7-8 years ago, just as long as I've been in school, you know, I felt like I always wanted to make a change, you know, through anything I was working through, whether it was like music or like anything entertainment, right. Like I always wanted to make a change and have some kind of like social power to what I was doing. You know, I come from like the school of Tupac, you know, and other, you know, people that were entertainers, but they were revolutionaries at the same time. You know, those are like kind of like my idols. And, I wanted to do similar things, you know what I mean? And I was at a time in my life where, you know, I was in the streets, you know, I had just got locked up. I was fighting a big case and, you know, I wanted to make a change. So that was around the time I was like, you know what? I love how the brain works. And I felt like this was the key to our progression, was getting our minds right.
Right.
So I decided to take that route. And and then I just started going to school.
That's dope. So initially when we met was at the Dame Dash Studios, and
right.
You guys were filming a show called Healing is Gangsta.
Yeah.
I mean, damn, that title alone is just powerful. I mean, Healing is Gangsta. I mean, why don't you tell us, you know, first off, why Healing is Gangsta? Why that title?
Well, I wanted to kind of flip the negative connotation that gangsta has amongst the people that are not part of our culture. Like, people that are part of our culture, mm-hmm. gangsta means a lot of different things.
For sure.
You know what I mean? It don't mean just like going out and gangbanging. You
right.
feel what I'm saying? Like, gangsta can mean, you know, oh, you taking care of your kids, that's gangsta.
Right.
Oh, I like that hat you got on. That's gangster. You know, being a man is gangster.
Right.
You know, so in our culture, we tend to take words and make them, you know, how we want them to mean, you know. And I just wanted to put a positive flip on the whole therapeutic aspect of it, you know, because I feel in our community, like, therapy is a taboo subject. I know it's getting a lot of press now, and you're seeing a lot of, you know, which is great. You know, you're seeing more of awareness now, and I'm just trying to keep that momentum going, you know. But I really wanted to, you know, I'm not opposed to helping everybody through what I do, but, you know, clearly I want to help the people from my community, and just trying to flip that negative narrative into a positive one.
That's amazing. Yeah. I mean, that, like I said, that title alone is very powerful. Everything about it, I mean, especially people, you know, coming from, you know, in human, like, you know, situations, you know, living in the gutter, coming from the ghetto, you know, living in the hood and stuff, you know, poverty, a lot of these things come in a factor where people deal with trauma, you know, which is a lot of the things I kind of wanted to get into. And so, well, you know, like you said, we met at the Dame Dash studio. So how did you form a relationship with Dame Dash?
Let's see. Well, I knew a lot of people that knew him already. Mm-hmm. But actually, we definitely got closer when I did Growing Up Hip Hop.
Okay.
On Wheaton Television. Yeah.
So what exactly was that?
That was basically, well, for those that don't know, Growing Up Hip Hop is a reality show, basically.
Okay.
Kind of based around hip hop. It deals a lot with hip hop icons and, like, their families and how they're, like, getting along in life and stuff like that.
Right.
And Brianna, who is a cast member, a lot of y'all might know her from the show, but she introduced me to the situation because at the time, Dame's son was having some difficulties in his life that she felt that I could help him with. So we did, like, a little intervention on the show.
Okay.
And yeah, and it went successful. You know, shout out to Bug, you feel me? He doing his thing, but it was successful. And, you know, originally I had came looking like the therapist. You know, I had the tie on, glasses on, you know what I mean? I did the whole nine, and or what they think a therapist would probably look like, I should say. But yeah, I came in with that. And so Dane was always, you know, he always showed me a lot of, you know, he was always grateful for what I did. Right. But he really took a liking to me, like, when he started asking other people that he knew about me. Okay. And he found out that I had this whole other side of my life before the therapy, before I became, like, a psychologist or marriage and family therapist. And he was like, wow, this is a real hood dude right here. You know what I'm saying? This was a hood dude who got history out here in these streets. And, I mean, he just saw the whole vibe. He was like, man, we need more like y'all, more like you here. You know what I'm saying? You know, you are the people that you're trying to treat. You feel me? And he just related to me on a whole other level when he found out that I was really from the streets and that, you know, we really knew a lot of the same people, you know, on the streets and in the industry as well, because obviously I've kind of been in the industry game for a while too, behind the scenes of doing things. So that's kind of how we, like, you know, cemented that relationship. And one day we was just talking, and I think he might have just sprouted it out. He was just like, man, healing is gangster, or it just came about. And I was just like, yo, we need to key that term right there. That's it.
That's it.
And it's been on ever since, you know. So he's been gracious enough to let me use a lot of his platform. And just trying to get this message out. As you can see, like, on his network, you know, he has a lot of things having to do with healing, you know, whether it's mental, physical,
for sure,
things like that. So, yeah.
I mean, definitely, I mean, shout out to Dame Dash, man. I mean, he's a legend in himself. That's a living legend. You know what I'm saying? Everything what he's been doing for the culture, for the people. I mean, it's amazing. You know what I'm saying? It's definitely amazing. And
it gave me extra confidence in what I was doing, because, you know, obviously if you look at Dame's history, he's good at picking out, like, diamonds in the rough, basically, or people that can bring something to the culture or add to it, you know. So it was cool.
That's dope. So, I mean, I know you said you have a lot of history in L.A., you know, as far as in the streets and working with a lot of people. I mean, I know initially when we met, we had some conversations where we even started speaking about Pac and stuff like that. And, and Nipsey, and just, you know, these two powerful icons, you know, who's unfortunately no longer with us. But she was fortunate enough to meet. I mean, why don't you tell me something about that?
Well, I was fortunate enough to actually, you know, be around these people.
Right.
You know what I mean? Obviously, at a young age, you know, I had several opportunities to be around Pac and, you know, pick up what I could. You know, I was really young, you know, so, you know, I definitely picked up what I could. And the times that I did get to, you know, be around him or be in contact with him, I learned a lot. You know what I'm saying? Also, his family, who is still my family to this day. You know, shouts out to Mo Prime, who's like my big bro. That's the godfather of my kids.
They were.
So I'm still. Yeah.
That's crazy. So yeah. That's real family ties right there.
Yeah. You know, shout out to Sexua, who is a Pac's sister, and rest in peace, Afeni. But
sure.
But yeah, so that I learned a lot as far as like the movement, you know, and communicating with people like Matulu Shakur, who's locked down right now. He's still a political prisoner.
Right.
He was a Black Panther back in the day, and just kind of learning from that, you know, learning from that whole experience, you know, learning from Mo, learning from Pac, you know, the good things he did, the mistakes he made, you know, obviously being human and being very young, you know.
I mean, you know, because he was very good when he passed away. What, 25, if I'm not mistaken?
25 years old. And right. You think about that, like, you talked to my other, you know, you talked about my other homeboy, Nip. Nip was 33. Right. You know what I'm saying? Which is still a baby in the grand scheme of life. You know what I'm saying? You don't learn that until you get older.
Right.
But you know, I was, you know, Nip, I was around, too, when I was young. I met Nip in, like, 99. When we was both still teens, we was both still teenagers, and I met him in that parking lot, actually.
So you met him where, at the Marathon Store parking lot, Crenshaw Slaw.
Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah, before it was ever a dream of any of that going on.
Crazy.
My homie had ran a store in that parking lot. It was a music store that, you know, and obviously, that was his neighborhood. You know what I'm saying? He was always there, whether it was moving something. You know, sometimes we would just be freestyling in the street. Sometimes we would just be rapping in the parking lot kicking it. You know, I was there really just holding my homie down. Every day, we was together like every day for a minute. You know, so that was my bro right there.
And that's crazy, man. I mean, those two people alone, man, inspired me to do a lot as well. You know what I'm saying? That's probably like my top two favorite artists, if even, you know what I'm saying? So that's amazing right there to hear that. So it actually brings to my next question, because I mean, both people who obviously were, you know, murdered, and that comes with a lot of trauma as well, you know, which is something that happens very so often in the streets. And we try to normalize that, you know, and by normalizing that, it comes with a lot of, undiagnosed stress, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
So I mean, what can you say about that? Because you obviously knew these two individuals. You must have felt some type of trauma yourself. I mean, explain that to us.
Well, I mean, the trauma thing goes, like, back hundreds of years. I mean, we're talking all the way back to slavery.
Wow.
Trauma is something that is, like, it's like a genetic disorder. It gets passed down through the generations.
Right. Right.
And, you know, because, you know, you got one. OK, let's say your parents dealt with a big trauma or weren't taught certain ways to deal with that trauma.
Yeah.
They pass that on to their kids and how they treat them, the values that get instilled in them, the fears that they had, things like that. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that already we dealing with on top of the daily stress of having to survive, you know. People like myself, you know, I was looking out for bullets by the time I was 6, 7 years old walking to school. Like, I already knew what time it was, you know. Like, I knew that at any given time, you know, the enemies or whoever else could come through and spray it up,
right.
You know. And this is me going to school feeling like this, you know. And as a young kid, you're not thinking about, oh, I'm going to be hard and, you know, all that. You just really scared. I was scared. I'm just going to keep it real. You know what I'm saying? I was 5, 6 years old. You know, I would see a van pull up slow, and I'm hiding behind trees, you know, just in case the drive-by was about to happen or something like that. Right. So that affected me mentally, meaning I was hyper-vigilant. When you're paranoid all the time, you're constantly in fight-or-flight mode. which means your heart rate, your heart rate is beating.
Yeah.
You feel me? The parts of your brain that are in charge of like learning,
right,
get shut down, because now you're just worrying about survival. So you can imagine when you live a whole life like that. Mm-hmm. All right, this starts to affect your circulatory system, your respiratory system, because your heart beating all the time. Mm-hmm. You're stressing.
Damn.
So the stress. So now stress hormones, cortisol is clogging your arteries.
Right.
Your mind is constantly shut down, worrying about living and dying, so you can't learn correctly. Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying? So these are just ways that trauma affects is just us coming up and learning things in school, operating. You know, I'm always ready to turn up at any given time, even when I'm not in the hood.
Right.
You know? Yeah. So these are the ways traumas affect us. Now, to go back to what you were saying, where we're dealing with a certain type of trauma where, you know, we're learning at early ages that you can die, that you can get murdered.
Right.
So now, excuse me. So, you know, when you're dealing with that kind of. But it's basically, there you go.
You got me?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, there you go. So basically what happens is we're not talking about it because we looked at it as being weak. You feel me? So when you talk about, you know, the pain that you're going through, you know, people always expect us to just be hard about it and not talk about it and just, hey, that's part of the game, bro. That's, you know, it is what it is. Mm-hmm. But again, you still feeling that trauma, whether you're talking about it or not.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? A lot of people talk about, you know, black on black crime. You feel me? Mm-hmm. That stems from a lot of trauma. You know, we're angry about our circumstances. We're angry about our environment.
Exactly.
We're angry about being poor. We're angry because the homie is not here with us no more. We're just angry all the time. So what happens is we're trapped in this hood, you know, and we just take it out on each other. That anger that makes it so easy for me to go shoot somebody that's just like myself.
Exactly.
Comes from a lot of anger that we're not talking about, that we're not recognizing. Because, again, being perceived as weak in these streets could get you killed. You get what I'm saying? And so I'm trying to change that narrative where it's like, it's okay to go get help. It's okay to talk to somebody about what you're going through, because when you talk to somebody outside of where we come from,
right,
no matter where you're from, East Coast, West Coast, down south, up north, any place where there's a hood, if you talk to somebody that ain't where we from, you could tell them just one aspect of your life that'll blow their mind. Like, damn, you live with that?
Like, damn,
you saw somebody get their brains blown out?
They shot,
oh,
like,
you saw some, you know, or you been shot? You, yeah. So imagine we deal with that every single day. You know, it's kind of like with the whole uprising that's going on right now, right? Mm-hmm. I hear a lot of police officers talking about how they feel unsafe right now because of everything that's going on. They like, well, I'm a good cop. You know, I don't do those things, but,
imagine,
you know,
how we've been feeling.
I feel unsafe because nobody likes the police. Well, I'm like, well, welcome to our everyday.
Exactly. Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? That's us every single day. So, man, trauma is a complicated thing, bro. You know, I'm currently writing a book about it.
Okay.
That will be out soon.
That's dope.
And it breaks down the different levels of trauma.
Definitely needed for the culture, man. I mean, you know, even me and myself, man, I've been through a lot, you know, at a young age, seeing things, you know, seeing my right-hand man, you know, take one to the face, you know. And like, I know that was like a turning point for me as well. You know, even from before, you know, I'm Haitian. So even being in Haiti, the Caribbean is wild too, you know. And, you know, you see a lot, man. And at a young age, you're trying to interpret what you're seeing and what's going on. And like, you know, everybody around you, like I said, normalize these things. So you just kind of just going on with life, just dealing with these open wounds in a sense. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. I'll salute to the homies in the chats. I see them.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Somebody here say free game.
Yeah,
this is definitely a free game right here. This is a free therapy session, man.
You know, again, just recognizing that the trauma in itself, just being conscious of the trauma, mm-hmm. is like the beginning step.
Right.
Right. You know what I'm saying? You know, and that's the part that I'm trying to get to with people. Then once you conscious of the trauma and how it's affecting you, now you could take steps to kind of mediate some of that trauma and, you know, and minimize some of the effects, you know, because again, we're dealing with hundreds and hundreds of years of trauma,
right.
You know, but this is the thing, this is what makes it difficult. And I kind of alluded to it before. What makes it difficult is the fact that we're dealing with the everyday trauma of trying to survive. So we don't even have time to process the past trauma from our past family, from ancestors, right. From all the things that are affecting us as well. So being able to calm ourselves down, like breathing, you know, mentalizing, being mindful, you know, practicing mindfulness, you know, these are all things that can extend our lives. You feel me? And, you know, again, even myself, I'm learning how to deal with it myself. You know, we talk about it a lot. I learned through school that most of the studies that they base psychology on is based on white folks.
Really?
Right? Yeah. There's not too much studies on like us. It's not too many studies about how to help us and, you know, the things that we're going through. The same racism that you see in law enforcement, the same racism that you see in these other professions exists in psychology too.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Right. So I'm kind of like going through the woods myself where it's dark. So I got this light and I'm learning things myself. Like, for instance, coming from a Caucasian standpoint of how they view things, right? Mm-hmm. They want to be able to calm themselves down so they just at peace. But I can't ignore the fact that the things that we scared of, the things that are traumatizing us, like murder and police brutality and oppression and all these things, they're real.
Right.
So we can't put ourselves in a frame of mind where we're just ignoring that, because we could still fall victim to it. So we still got to stay ready for that. Right. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah. So the trick is to find a good homeostasis or medium of not being paranoid all the time, but still being ready. Mm. And that's something that ain't been studied at all. That I'm studying currently.
That's a good point. That's a very good point. So I mean, I'm assuming we can expect to get some more of that in your book that you said is going to be coming out, right?
Absolutely.
All right. So let me ask you this. I think a lot of people have the idea that, like, therapy is for crazy people, or I ain't crazy, I don't need that, or whatever the case may be. And I think there's a lot of different forms of mental illness that people get confused of, you know what I'm saying? And I wanted to really clarify the two different things, right? Well, first, let's get into mental illness. Like, what exactly is that?
I mean, mental illness is basically, it's two things, actually, because you got behavior that a lot of people will misconstrue as mental illness, but it's really just maladaptive behavior that you can sometimes reverse with things like cognitive behavioral therapy.
Okay.
Which basically tells you how to think about things different and how to behave about them differently.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So you got that. Then you got mental illness in the biological sense, which is like being bipolar or being schizophrenic, which actually affects you chemically. Which sometimes you'll see people taking medicine for that. You know what I'm saying? Right. And also getting psychotherapy. You know what I'm saying? So that's kind of the difference. Mm. But really, mental illness is really anything that is maladaptive in your life. And maladaptive meaning affects you negatively. Like, it affects you, you know, it may stop you from going to work. It may stop you from functioning normally and being able to be sociable. You know, it may detach you from reality.
Right.
Things like that. You know, right. Some of us have different quirks. You know, you can look in a DSM. Like, our basic thing is a DSM. It kind of lists all the medical illnesses as far as in the mind, right?
What's a DSM? What exactly is that?
The Diagnostic Manual.
Diagnostic Manual. Okay.
He has medical professionals follow as far as when we map out mental illness.
Okay, got it.
But the thing about that is any normal person can look in there and be like, well, that's me. That's me. I got this. I got that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's not about necessarily symptoms. It's about if it's affecting you negatively, if it's messing your life up. That's when you know you got an issue.
Right. Okay. So,
you know what I'm saying?
So, because, you know, typically, like I said, people be like, damn, I don't know if I got this. And I don't, you know, they don't want to seem crazy. Some people really are too shy to even discuss things like that or you know, maybe even a question of their manhood in a sense. I'm not sure what it is, but it's something that's preventing people from taking that initiative of seeking help. And I think part of it is also knowing how to or where to seek help. You know, is it like a financial thing, you think, or like what are the resources for people to do so?
Well, to address your initial question, I think it's a mixture of both. I think it's again, from where we come from, I think a lot of people don't want to look weak. Mm. You know what I mean? They don't want to seem like they need help. Because we dealing in, you know, we live amongst wolves out here a lot of the times, you know what I'm, that are looking for any weakness
right.
to take something, you know what I'm saying? Because they living in poverty and they desperate, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
So I think it's that. Finance, yeah, definitely. But there are resources to address your second question.
Okay.
They do have foundations in different, in most cities where they'll give people that are coming from low income backgrounds, you know, they'll give them what is called a sliding scale, which means they'll go by whatever income they bringing in,
right.
and that's how much they would pay. So, you know, some people might be paying $20 a session. Some people might be paying nothing, you know, depending on your situation.
Okay.
You know, so they do have resources for that. You just got to kind of tap into them. And, you know, I know of some like in L.A., you know what I mean?
So some resources for people that's available for people if they need immediate help, in other words.
Yeah, you got to just kind of, you know, you got to go into your community centers and kind of, you know, see what's what, you know what I mean?
Right.
Me personally, like if you're out here, I know about some, you know, there's one called Open Paths that I work with, which is an agency I work with sometimes. For them, for instance, they'll go by your income, you know what I mean? And what you're able to afford. You know, for younger people, you know, I also work with another agency called Social Justice. I work with them like in Compton a lot in some of the different LA areas and actually go to the schools and talk to the students for free, you know, where I do a little, yeah, I do community groups or like therapy groups, or do individual therapy with certain young students that might be, you know, like at risk or, you know,
right.
going through the same things I went through at that age.
Right.
So,
I mean, because that's what starts, right? You know what I mean? You got to start from the root.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, it just depends. You know, you can go through the high schools to find resources like that. Or, I mean, you can Google a lot of that stuff, too. You know, you can Google some of these places.
Right.
You know.
Okay.
Yeah. Or like income driven therapy, you know, like you can look it up, you know, but there's always resources. And if not, you could, if you do want to tap in with me, you know, you can hit me in a DM. If it's something I could do to help any of y'all watching, just let me know what's up.
That's another free game right there, man. You know what I mean? Free game, free session. I suggest anybody that's tapping in, you know, definitely follow this man, you know, tune in, and continue to follow his journey as well. Still got some more questions for you, man.
Mm-hmm.
I got a lot, man. I'm hoping I can try to squeeze all this in because there's so much.
Hey, let's go.
Just go over and touch basis on PTSD, man. I know we spoke a little bit about trauma. You know, let's talk about that. What exactly is that?
PTSD is an acronym. It stands for post-traumatic stress disorder.
Okay.
Post-traumatic stress disorder is something that is diagnosed when you've been through something traumatic and it's affecting you in daily life, much like what we just talked about.
Exactly.
You know, like a lot of times it's documented from like a military perspective. That's when it really first started getting looked at, is when they were dealing with like the military, like they were going out and they were going into battle and, you know, they was coming back home trying to readjust, but their mind was still stuck in being in battle.
Right.
You know what I mean? And this was affecting their daily life. You know, they was driving more reckless, they couldn't control their tempers, you know, they were very aggressive, you know, so that's kind of like where it got turned. Now, the post-traumatic stress in the sense of what we're talking about is more complex than that. You know, you got PTSD and then you got complex PTSD. Complex PTSD deals more with what we're talking about, like genetic trauma, like generational trauma.
Yeah,
you know, that transmits.
You're kind of breaking up a little bit.
Can you hear me now? You got me?
I can hear you, but I can't see you. Let me... Okay, now it's clearing up. It's clearing up.
All right. Yeah, so basically what I was saying was it's complex PTSD stems from like generational trauma, you know, everyday trauma, because a lot of our trauma is similar to being in warfare.
Right.
You know, anybody that's, you know, in the streets or gang banging or, you know, been in a shootout, you know, or been shot or worries about being shot, you know, or seen somebody else be shot. You know, that's all trauma and that's all post-traumatic stress. That's where it gets complex. You know what I mean? Because, I mean, I was talking with somebody else that came from the military. And I told, and they was telling me, and I was like, man, we go through that too.
Right, right, right. I mean,
you know,
pretty much it's just, I mean, they might, shit, people got the same artillery in the streets too, but, you know.
I mean, either way, you're worrying about dying. You're worrying about dying. You know, you're seeing people get shot. I mean, as far as I can speak on my own life, I've seen all that.
Right. Right.
I've been in the shootouts. I've been in where the bullets was flying, and you know, those are traumatic things. That's warfare. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
It's in the city, but it's warfare. You feel me? And that's something that can traumatize you for life, and it could debilitate you for life if you don't know how to handle it.
I mean, yeah, man. Like I said, man, just going through little things myself at a young age, it's tough, man, and it kind of haunts you in a sense, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, even my man that I said that took one to the face, when we probably was like 14, 15 maybe, when that happened, he's still living to this day, though, you know, fortunately. And the crazy thing is that, you know, he was able to change his life. You know, it took a little bit of time, you know what I'm saying, a little fed time and stuff like that, but, you know, things happen or so. But I think these type of situations change you for the worse, you can change for the best, you know what I'm saying? And unfortunately, a lot of people change for the worse because they still in the same environment. You know what I'm saying? And so,
right.
Like, what's next? You know, that's why they say, you know, the outcome, unfortunately, is, you know, dead or in jail. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I feel like, you know, I feel like that's why it's so important for us to deal with this post-traumatic stress, you know, now. You feel me? Because I feel like, whatever movement that we want to start or that has started, you know, as far as socially, you know, with the protests and the, you know, the uprisings and things like that, imagine how much better and more cohesive that is if we got our minds together and we know how to deal with our own stress.
Right.
How much better we'll be able to think about what we want to do, you know, not making irrational decisions in the movement, you know what I'm saying? Because I'm going to tell you like this, if we start this, right, and then we just stop,
right,
it's going to set us back even worse than where we started.
Because we, like, reopen the wound.
Exactly. So it's like,
right.
So while we going to legislation and talking about changing these laws and holding police accountable and doing all these things, we also need to be taking care of us internally. Exactly. Feel me?
Right.
And making sure that we right and making sure that, you know, our brothers and sisters is right so that we could stay on this movement for the long haul, for the long term, not just for a couple of weeks or a year. You know, this took us hundreds of years to get into this position. It's going to take us a while to get out.
Right. So, I mean, it just goes to my next question, because we obviously talked about how this goes way back to slavery. So it's fair to say that society and racial issues play a role in our mental health.
Absolutely.
Okay. And so how do we break the cycle of a poor recognition of self? You know, how do we break that cycle?
I mean, we break the cycle by first slowing everything down, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying, within our own mind. Because, again, we can't take care of nobody else if we don't take care of ourselves.
Okay.
You know, I always say that the best thing that you could do for somebody that you're about to help is help yourself.
Right.
You feel me? So I feel like we got to look at the mirror and really see how these things are affecting us. You know, a lot of times the bravest thing that you can do is face yourself. It's easy to tell somebody else what to do.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's easy to tell, you know, but it's hard to look at yourself and say, man, I'm having issues struggling with this.
Exactly.
You know, noticing your physical pain where you stress at. Some people feel it in their chest. Some people feel it in their shoulders. You know, noticing little things like that can help you stop. Noticing where your stress is mounting up at.
Right.
Can help you control your anger. You know, like, because you can feel it like, oh, wait, my chest starting to tighten up. I'm starting to get upset. Let me breathe so I don't hurt this person or I don't hurt myself.
Right.
You know what I mean? So I think that's where it starts. It's self-awareness. Mm. You feel me? Self-awareness, recognizing that you have an issue, you know, that you're dealing with something. And then the next is, you know, getting some help for it. Like, really taking the time to do that. You know, we you know, when people talk about hustling and all that, you know, they always talk about, oh, I'll sleep when I'm dead.
I ain't gonna lie.
You know, I never agreed with that. You
I
know
used
what I'm
to
saying?
Be one of those people, man. Like, man, sleep. I'm up all night grinding. You know what I'm saying? But I realize that's crazy. You know, sleep is how
it's crazy. If you don't sleep, you ain't gonna be able to do nothing.
Right. Exactly, man.
You know what I'm saying? And it'd be little things like that. Take the time, all the time that we've taken to chase the bag, take some of that time to heal yourself.
Right.
Rest. Enjoy the life around you. You know what I'm saying? Like, we spend so much time grinding for things that we're not enjoying life.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, go outside and breathe. You know, go outside and be thankful for something. You know, be thankful for the roof you got over your head. You know?
Yeah.
You know, whatever little money you got, be thankful for that. You know, thankful for your family. Doing things that make you feel good, that don't take no money to do. Spending time with your kids.
Mm. So
you know what I'm saying?
To answer one of my next questions, which was like, so what are some things you can do that's you know, doesn't cost any money whatsoever. You know what I'm saying? Whenever feeling stressed, like common exercises that you can do.
I like to do like breathing techniques. Again, for anybody that's watching, you can look it up. It's called mindfulness techniques. And there's different breathing techniques that you can do. You know, there's some that you can do. Like, I do them in traffic sometimes when I'm driving.
Mm, okay.
You know, and somebody done cut me off or somebody done, you know, and I feel like, you motherfucker, I'm finna, you know, woo, woo.
Right,
you know,
right.
what I try to, you know, yo, what it is.
That's me all day out here, man. I ain't gonna lie. This L.A. traffic is crazy. What?
Right? You know? You know, out here in L.A., we got the 405, you know, the traffic be insane. You feel me?
Oh, man. So, yeah.
So, I just breathe, you know. I breathe in for 5 seconds,
mm.
You know. And, you know, I hold it for a second, you know. And then I'll breathe out for 6 or 7 seconds.
Right.
You know. If I'm feeling any stress, like I said, if I feel stressed in my chest or I feel, like, any tightness anywhere,
yeah,
I'll mentally direct my breath to that part of my body.
Mm.
Now, what you're doing is you're feeding your brain and your body oxygen, okay? The brain and the body talk to each other, okay?
Okay.
Yeah, so if I'm breathing in oxygen, I'm telling my body that I'm cool, that I'm calm, right?
Right.
So that, in turn, my body tells my brain, hey, you know what? We're not tripping right now. Everything is cool.
Right.
So the oxygen opens up the brain. It opens up your frontal cortex. So where everything slows down, now you can think again rationally. You can realize that you're not being chased by a bear. You're not ducking bullets. There's no need for me to get into a fight with this dude in the next lane that might turn into something serious, you know.
Right.
You know, so that's what I do. I do a lot of breathing. Some people, like my homegirl Debbie Dev, shout out to Daisy. What's up, Daisy? You know, I do a lot of breathing. Like my homegirl Debbie Dev teaches a lot about, like, meditation.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a lot of different types of meditation and just kind of finding your energy. Like, again, but it all comes down to breathing.
Yeah, right. You know? Right.
For the beginner, just do some breathing techniques. Like, it helps a lot.
Right. Okay. I mean, overall, I think just finding things that you enjoy doing. You know, you know, to help with that process as well, in my opinion. That's what I found kind of worked for me, you know what I mean? But also, I found that I at times use pain and everything that I've been through, excuse me, as like my source of motivation, you know what I'm saying? And I feel like, I, you know, by doing that, you're not necessarily healing. You're kind of just, neglecting the real emotion and just using it as a different type of drive. You know what I'm saying? And that's what I found myself doing a lot, you know?
Well, creatively, that's you can use creative to heal. You know what I'm saying? Hold on 1 second. Sorry, in the call.
Yeah, the client's calling in. Oh,
yeah. You can hear me though, right?
No, I hear you. Yep.
Okay. So, basically, as far as creative stuff, like writing stuff, like hip hop is therapy. Mm-hmm. That was my therapy for a long time before I knew what therapy was.
Yeah, music in general, I think, is therapeutic for sure.
Yeah. Hold on, let me turn up my volume a little bit. There we go. All right. Yeah, but like, writing what you're going through. You know, people, when you get in the booth and you spit it. You know what I'm saying? You know, when you're listening to music, when you're listening to I listen to a lot of Stevie Wonder. You know what I'm saying? You know, listening to Nip. A lot of people listen to, they might listen to X. You know, they might listen to whoever. That's therapy too.
Right.
You feel me? So.
Right.
It's a lot of different ways of therapy. You know, whatever gets you through and it's healthy and it brings you, it makes you where it's easier for you to focus and just, and just calm down. Whatever it is, right. Anything creative is great for therapy. Painting. Like I said, writing music, if it's DJing, if it's whatever, man, whatever takes you away. You feel what I'm saying?
Exactly.
That's therapy.
Especially for people that's working hard, working 9-to-5s, dealing with kids, dealing with a breakup, whatever the case may be, entertain yourself, man. Find what's your passion, find what makes you, I think it's highly.
You got real low. I don't know if that's my phone or yours.
Let me make sure. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. It's just low.
Yeah, man. You know this IG, man. They don't want us to have this real session going on, man. It's free game.
Yeah, it's all good. I can still hear you though.
All right, word. So look, man, we crunching it on time right now. I wanted to ask you something else. So long-term effects, I think we kind of spoke about that. Undiagnosed stress. Let me ask you this: What is a typical therapy session like with you? Like, what can somebody expect? On a one-on-one, like how does it normally go?
Well, it depends on it depends on the client a lot, and what they're going through. Some people are going through like crisis-related situations, mm-hmm. and what I focus on when they're going through like a crisis situation is calming them down in that moment.
Right.
It might be concentrating on a color on the wall or the birds chirping or whatever. I try to bring them in the moment.
Mm. Everybody's experience is different pretty much.
Yeah. If it's something that's long-term, like long-term therapy, let's say they're dealing with some kind of abandonment issue, or they got something that's, their parents might've been mistreating them or, they have some kind of issue like that. I try to get them in a place where they can look back at those experiences without being overwhelmed.
Right.
So I do that. But a lot of my therapy is just relating with the client. I'm very relatable. I try to meet them wherever they at. For instance, for the younger people that I talk to, like the high school students and stuff, it could be just breaking the ice. We talk about a lot of different things. We might talk about music, what's popping in music. Or, what they like doing day to day. If it's sports, all right, well, what's your favorite sports team? And just kind of building that relationship with them, because this is about trust. They're trusting me with, things that are very sensitive to me, to them. Right. You know what I'm saying? I should say things that they might have never told nobody else. Mm-hmm. You feel me? So it's important that I establish a relationship with them, that they can trust me and that they know that their secrets are safe with me, right, and that they're in a safe space with me when they're communicating and that I won't judge them. That's the main thing, is knowing that they won't be judged.
That's dope. So
for whatever they're going through.
Let me also ask you this. So you, I think you said, you mentioned you do marital counseling as well.
What was that?
Marriage counseling. Is that, you said you do that as well?
Yeah.
Is that, what's the correct terminology for that? Is it marriage counseling or?
Well, marriage and family therapy is
okay.
That kind of that can anything can fit into that. I mean, a lot of people hear the title and they're like, oh, you know, it's just marriage counseling or it's just family counseling. Mm-hmm. Now, within that is also individual counseling. Mm-hmm. My doctorate degree, which is in clinical psychology, deals with like assessments. Like, you know, I might be able to give you an assessment and say, okay, well, this is probably what you're diagnosed with.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So marriage and family therapy is more about the actual psychotherapy of talk therapy, whether it's family, individual, marriage, whatever. Clinical psychology does that, but also assesses. Like, I'll give you an actual test, like an assessment, like an IQ test.
Yeah.
Or a test to see if maybe you're suffering from an actual mental illness.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. That's dope. That's definitely important too. I mean, because there's many different forms of stress that we deal with on a day to day. You know, relationships being one of them. Which, if you have kids, can you hear me?
Yeah, I'm just working on this. Hold on one sec.
Ultimately could affect the family, kids, and it becomes a cycle. It becomes a cycle in the family, and as you said, passed on from generations or through your DNA, you know, on and so forth, man. This is dope, man. I really appreciate everything you've been doing with us, man. Like this was so important, man. I can't stress this enough. You know, hopefully this could even save somebody's life. You know what I'm saying? You never know. I guarantee you somebody somewhere needed to hear this, you know, and if not, they will be hearing it, you know. Healing is gangster. How can we, you know, tune in, you know, tell us, you know, for the people that don't know.
Yeah, you could, you could find us on the Dame Dash Television, which you can subscribe to. You can go to his page, Dusko Poppington, and you can actually subscribe to the Dame Dash Studios. Which has my show and a bunch of other shows. You can find Healing is Gangsta on YouTube as well.
Okay.
Go to the YouTube channel. All the episodes are there. Most of the episodes that we've released are there, along with clips. You can also just tune in to Instagram. You know, if you we got Healing is Gangsta Official, which is the actual Instagram page for Healing is Gangsta.
Okay, dope.
But you can catch all the clips and the different guests.
I'll make sure.
You can also come to my page, TAJE310. That's TAJE. 310, and I'm always posting clips and, you know, the different interviews. You know what I mean? We got some more of season one coming. I've just started filming season two. You know, hence, you know, like if you watch season one, I don't have the beard. This time I have the beard.
Word.
You know what I mean? So that's how you can tell the difference.
Is this after you went to Mecca? Is that what happened?
Huh?
You went to Mecca and then you came back. Is that what happened?
Ah, right. You know? Yep. I came back. And then it was quarantine time, so I was like, I'm just going to let it grow and, you know, do what it do. Okay.
Word. Dope, man. Hey, man, I'm going to let you go in a little bit, but before we do, there's something that I want to do with everybody that I have on here. I'm a filmmaker, as you know, and so I got some quick little movie trivia questions for you. This is, you know, being L.A.-based, you from out here, so I'm going to try to make it a little easy for you. You know what I mean? So you ready for it?
Yeah, it's like okay, so you're going to ask me something, basically. Yeah, I just need to answer
quick, it. Quick three little questions, three little movie trivia-related questions.
Okay.
And, you know, it's L.A.-based films and things like
okay.
that. So just try to make it a little easier. So let's get into it. Number one, name three movies Tupac played in.
Name three movies?
Yeah, three movies.
That are L.A.-based, right?
Nah, it don't got to be L.A.-based, just three movies in general. He's an L.A. artist as well, you know what I'm saying? So that's why I say L.A.
Okay.
Any movie.
It could be any movie?
Any movie. Any Tupac movie. Name three.
Oh, Tupac movie. Oh, Tupac movie.
Tupac.
Oh, come on, man. Come on, man. Juice.
Word.
A Butter Rim.
Word.
Poetic Justice.
Word. There we go. Man, you know what I mean? That's my first three that I have too listed right here. Don't lie. That's dope. All right. Next question. What is Ice Cube's first movie debut and what year?
First Ice Cube movie?
Yes, sir. Let's get it.
Oh, Boys in the Hood.
Boys in the Hood. Let's get it. That's a fact.
Dope Boy.
Yes, sir. Now tell me this. Do you know what year though?
Huh?
Do you know what year? You remember what year it was?
I want to say that came out at the same time like Death Certificate came out. So I want to say like 91.
Ooh,
something like okay. That, 90.
Okay, then. I like that. I like that. My man knows his stuff right here. Respect. All right. Now, my final question is, well, this one might not really be L.A. related, but I figured you should know this one right here. Shout out to Dame Dash as well. Who are the three main characters in the Paid in Full movie, which was produced by Dame Dash?
I didn't get the middle part. What was it?
What are the name of the three main characters from the Paid in Full movie?
Oh, the three main characters? Like the in the movie or the actual people they play?
No, not the real life. We ain't gonna get into the real life story, but the movie characters.
Oh, just in the movie.
The movie
okay.
Characters.
You got A, you know, Ace Boogie, you feel me?
Right. One.
You got Mitch.
Two.
There you got Rico.
And Rico, let's get it, man.
Oh yeah, you know I'm a connoisseur, baby. If it's the culture, you know I got it.
Salute. Respect. You gotta get that. Well, I mean, you working with Dame all the time, so I mean, even for the streets, that's a street classic right there as well. Yo, TAJE, man, it's been a pleasure, my brother. You know, I wish we had more time to continue this going, but you know, we definitely gonna have to get something going again sometime soon. You know, just for the culture, for the people. This was dope, man. I really do appreciate this, my brother, a lot.
Oh yeah, and I want to send a shout out to everybody else tuning in and out. You know what I'm saying? Shout out to y'all. You know what I mean? Miss Hoboken, Manson, I see you up in here. What's up, bro? You Seth was in here earlier. My goddaughter Daze was up in here. What's up? Anybody that was you know up in here, man? What's up? And I definitely want to come back, you know what I mean, and continue some of these conversations. I think they're important. And likewise, you know, I would love to have you on the show. You know what I'm saying? So,
word.
Feel me?
Nah, listen.
So, you know, some of your experiences can help somebody else, go, you know, with what they're going through.
Most def, man. We're gonna do some things, man. We got TAJE, man, healing this gangster. Salute, my brother. Till the next time.
Salute, man. I'll see y'all in a minute.
You all ready?
100.
Word, that was dope. Yo, shout out to everybody that was in here, man, you know, tuning in. I really appreciate y'all, you know what I'm saying? This was definitely highly important for the culture. This is dope. We got somebody else coming up next, you know what I mean? We got undefeated professional boxer. Man, we're going to get into some stuff right now. Stay tuned, people. We're going to log out. Instagram about to kick us off right now. We're gonna log out and log back in. So y'all stay tuned. Let's get it. This is the Guest Room Saturdays. Yeah.